So thank you very much for showing up. Is there anyone that was not present or has not seen the presentation from yesterday? In that case, it will be somewhat of a wild ride. Given the fact that we are in this smaller tent, we can be more interactive. The good news is yesterday I had 1.5 hours of content and 1 hour to do it in. Today I have 1/2 hour of content and 1 whole hour to do it in. That means that at any time you should feel free, raise your hand, ask questions. We left out some of the cool bits yesterday. The story is, can we understand DNA in a way that we, as computer nerds, most of us, can understand better? And one of the slides where we left it off yesterday is what I call reverse engineering a 4-billion-year-old software project. So when we read DNA, we have machines, you can buy them. Some of them are this big and cost like 50,000 euros. But they're like printers. So you own one for 50,000 euros, it costs 1,000 euros each time you use it. They actually use the same tricks as HP does. There are cartridges that have to go in there, and they expire for no good reason. It's a horrible company that makes them, and the horrible thing is they are so good at what they do. Horrible. There are now also DNA sequencers that are this big. And these machines are really cheap to buy. They are literally a USB device. You can stick them in your computer. If you drip well-prepared DNA into the USB device, it will start reading it. And it's cheap too. So now you know what is coming. The quality utterly sucks. However, due to the fun active statistics, you can make many copies of DNA, read them 1 million times, or hundreds of times with bad quality, and then you can average them out as good quality. But what I'm saying is, these days it is quite possible to take a piece of life and read out its DNA and learn what is inside there. And when people started doing that for real, they found out that we have exactly 3 kinds of life on Earth, which are very, very weirdly related to each other. So we have plants, fungi, animals, us, fish, the whole thing, they are all one tree of life. Under a microscope, it is not that easy to see the difference between a cell of me and a cell of a plant. The wall is thicker, but all the components are the same. So we have more in common with a blade of grass than with bacteria. Then when people took their DNA readers to read all those bacteria, they found out there were 2 entirely different kinds of bacteria that have nothing to do with each other. And by nothing, I mean like nothing. So let's say you have an Ethernet connection at home, and someone else has a token ring network. You might go like, the Ethernet and the token ring, both packets, I could make a connector between these two. No, you cannot make a connector between these two because they are such different worlds. Thank you very much. Saves a lot of shouting. So people found that all the bacteria are actually 2 kinds of bacteria, and they sort of look the same, but they are completely different. And at first, to make sense of that stuff, they said, well, half of these bacteria, they must be older than the other one. So we call them archaea, which means old.
No.
It just turns out that nature is as messy as we are and comes up sometimes with 2 things. So bacteria and archaea look alike, but if you look how they build themselves, how they build their cell wall, how they copy themselves, they're completely different. So that's a little bit weird because both of them are doing well. Both, you could call both of them bacteria, but if you're wise, you could call one of them archaea. But the weirdness is not over. We have the bacteria and the archaea, okay? And these are small things. You may remember from yesterday that bacteria and archaea have 1,000 times less DNA than we do, more or less. 3 orders of magnitude difference. That's a lot. So there is a large gulf between us and the bacteria, very large gulf. We know that we came later. We do know that. We know that the bacteria were here first. So if you now skip to the next slide. This is a lovely presentation. This is from a notebook from Charles Darwin, the father of evolution. And he was, by the way, a very special person. He was super duper dedicated to his work. But here's the interesting thing. By his own admission, he was not a genius. But he was just super disciplined and worked super hard on it. And you can see that in one of his notebooks. So at least you could see it, in theory, if you were smart enough to make good projectors. On the left, he has drawn, you can see it also on the right, a tree of life. It was his first instinct how life would get other life, and you would get this tree of life where we descend from something monkey-like or whatever. And on top of that, he wrote the wise words, "I think." He wasn't quite sure. And this was a few years earlier. Then a few years later, he actually stopped thinking, apparently. And then he drew, he drew this lovely white paper. On which, in very fine ink, you can see a very neat tree of life where this plant has generations later becomes that plant, and it all hangs together, much like we know that the dinosaurs turned into birds and that stuff. It was all very neat. And it also turned out to be completely wrong. This is a tradition, this presentation. So if you go to the next slide, maybe you can see this. Remember, the bacteria and the archaea, they came first. And it really looks like that they both got their start at the same time. So there were two ways of making a bacterium. One was the actual bacteria, the other one was the archaea. Both of them worked. They're very different, but they're still around. Like maybe in previously we would have that with VHS and Betamax, for some of the really old people here, like me. But not one of them won, they both won, they stayed around. The big question then is, of course, we started out with these bacteria, with simple genomes, 1,000 times smaller. How did we get to those complicated animals, 1,000 times larger? And we think that we have found it out. We have forensic proof from the DNA that we know what happened. And it now looks like, remember this neat tree of life that Darwin drew for us? And it far more looks like this tree of life, where we have two simultaneously starting pieces of life, the bacteria and the archaea. And then one day, a bacterium came along, and it was a very unhappy day for the bacterium. It got eaten by an archaea, and it survived. And so it sat there within the archaea, and it did its thing, because it was a lovely environment, because there was glucose and everything. And these two apparently made friends and survived. And from that, that actually they could live together, and the bacterium within the archaea built a wall around itself to protect itself from the hostile archaea. And from that on, we have a plan, a step process, where we end up from the very simple bacteria to our very complex selves. So it really looks like that we consist of an archaea that ate a bacterium and both survived. So that's us, so now you know. How do we know this stuff? How do we know that this is, why do we think this? Because it's on the face of it, it's a rather ridiculous theory. And so you have to come up with some serious proof to make that happen. So what we know, if we look at the bacterial, sorry, at our DNA, there is the people DNA in there, which is us, and we recognize that, really people DNA. And then there's a tiny bit left of clearly bacterial DNA. It's still there, and it has its own ribosomes, like the 3D printer I described yesterday that builds everything. In every cell that we have, with a few billion exceptions, how these things go, there lives the mitochondria. Mitochondria are the energy powerhouses of our cells, and they are actually ancient bacteria. And we know that because if we read this little bit of mitochondrial DNA and we go, look, can we find bacteria that have that same DNA? Then we still find free living bacteria that look like our mitochondria. So if you have this bunch of bacteria and you hate them and you kill them with spray and whatever, they're your cousins. Be careful with them. And that's still around. So this leads to this messy tree of life where we started out with an archaea that ate a bacterium and then became us. But the story doesn't stop there. When people started looking, they see that these bacteria and us continue to exchange DNA. So normally you would say you get your DNA from your father and mother and you push it down the line. Or in this graph, you push it up the line. But it turns out that bacteria are bigly into open source. And we'll get to that a few slides from here, and they keep exchanging information. That makes it very difficult to make sense of what's going on. But we do know a few things. And when you write a compiler for a programming language, the question always is, in what language do you write that compiler? The ideal programming language, you write the compiler for that programming language in the language itself. Which is really nice. It's a nice trick if you can get away with it. And only serious languages can do this. And the big question, of course, is how did this start? How did life start here? And the problem is, when we go back, and there's a thing called the last universal common ancestor, which we call LUCA. It's a nice name for it, for a very tiny bacterium or an archaea. And we already know that if we look what all domains of life have in common, and it looks like that the original life that started already had a ribosome. And this leads to many dark questions. In the library of books here, I have a book called The Vital Question, and that's written by a very mainstream biologist, not a weird guy, I promise, not a weird guy. And he starts his book with, at the heart of biology, there's a dark hole. And that's the part where we say, it's a bit weird that the first life form that we know of was already quite advanced. The theory is that it came out of a vent in the ocean where you have a sort of sulfur boiling up, and it's hot, and it has all kinds of interesting chemicals, and it's like a sort of soup of life. And there is a sort of credible story to be made that you can start life from there. This one we did yesterday. Ah, the open source, sharing and plugins. They've been at it for longer than we have. So bacteria, they can exchange genetic material with each other. This is not a romantic thing, although it does involve things that stick into other bacteria. This can happen in two ways. They can literally take a gene from their own DNA and give it to another bacterium. It's nice, but more recognizable for us is a thing called the plasmid. And the plasmid is a little plugin. There's no other word for it. It's a little piece of its own DNA. It's a little circle. Actually, it's not a circle, but they like to draw it as a circle. It's a really messy sort of bun. And this plasmid can have specific capabilities. So sometimes there are bacteria that are known to be resistant to certain antibiotics. And these guys, they have managed to put that resistance on a plasmid. So a bacterium that has found out how to become resistant against antibiotics can give that gift to another bacterium. So thank you for that. And actually these plasmids, as they are called, they float around. There's like a soup of them. And bacteria mix and match until they find something that works, which is a little bit like going to GitHub and downloading libraries until you get what you want. This strategy does not work for us. Well, some people do it. Well, it works really well for bacteria because they live by the billions. A billion bacteria is nothing. A billion bacteria are growing in my fridge right now. And there's nothing for them. So they can make a billion attempts to see what works. And if one works, it works spectacularly well. So we also have these libraries of plasmids to study. And if you want to investigate how a bacterium works, you can do something that we did at TU Delft. Actually, they did it before I came, so I cannot claim any credit for that. They took a bacterium and erased part of its DNA, which gives you a rather sad bacterium. I mean, it doesn't die, but it also is not happy. It doesn't, it just sits there. And then you reintroduce the piece of DNA you cut out as a plasmid. And you see, does the bacterium become happy again? So it's like removing the web server from some kind of appliance and putting in your own web server and seeing if it works. And in that way, you are able to put in all kinds of different plasmids to figure out what would happen if you took the whole bacterium and changed only one thing? So these guys are into sharing and open source, and they even have special things for that to stick into. You cannot really see it here, but they have a sort of tube that they plug into each other and share DNA, which does not sound very romantic. That's how they roll. Malware. I keep forgetting this. You say, yeah, my computer, there's a worm on the internet. I'm not quite sure why they call it a worm, by the way, because it goes rather fast. Or there's a virus. And we really forget that in the computing world, we took the word virus from biology. It's not that computers invented this stuff. When computers started doing this, we're like, oh yeah, it's like these bacteria. But that is really exactly how it works. The virus is nothing short of a remote code execution. There is no other word for it. And I'll show you how that works. Still find it somewhat scary. So this is the hepatitis B virus. Many of us will have had it. It's not a pleasant experience. It involves a lot of time in the bathroom. And it's, like I said yesterday, it's 800 bytes. But these 800 bytes are enough to make you very ill. What happens? And we can do this. We can make this. We can order up this small ring of DNA in the middle. 800 bytes. If you Google for the DNA vector, you can order this stuff online, and they will ship it to you in the bag. And it's routine. It's very routine use. And doesn't mean that it's quite that easy, by the way, to build a virus. But if you manage to get that 800 bytes of DNA into a human cell, that human cell will start making this whole virus again. So in here you see this little circle of DNA, and there's stuff around it, and there's a membrane which it uses to actually penetrate the cell. So this is the whole computer, this is the whole thing. But if I take only the DNA and put it into a cell, your cell, my cell, it will start making this thing, which is the very definition of an exploiting a system. There's no other way. This is a sort of buffer overflow. It's even cleverer than that, because it has to evade all kinds of active defenses. But once the DNA is in there, it subverts the cell and launches a sort of denial of service campaign, where that cell starts doing nothing else but making more copies of this virus thing. So the word virus or malware for what we find on the internet on our computers is actually indistinguishable from this stuff. Except that whenever I find someone that tries to hack my system, they need a little bit more than 800 bytes. So it's a very clever thing. But this is, I love this one. I have one with me.
I can get it.
So life always finds a way. Thank you, Benny, for giving me this briefly. Life always finds a way. So not only are there bacteria that are trying to infect us all day long, there are viruses that are trying to infect us all day long, and there are viruses that are trying to infect your bacteria. Which is somewhat great news, because it's rather nice, because these bacteria, quite frequently, they make us ill. So wouldn't it be lovely if we could take something like this? And you might think that this is a joke. You might think, no way, that there is a bacterial virus that looks like this. Of course, this one has little eyes, so I have to admit that the real ones, as far as we know, do not have little eyes. And we've been able to figure out what these look like. This is a T5 bacteriophage, which lives on E. coli bacteria. On the left is what we know that it looks like, for real. This looks like straight out of science fiction. You would not believe that anything would look like this. What this does, it takes these five legs, it lands on a bacterium, and then exactly what you think it would do, it rotates itself into there with this sort of boring machine. And then it injects the DNA, and then that bacterium starts making more of these guys. That's really how it works. And so on the left, that's a sort of what it would look like if we had the best microscope in the world and the smaller photons than exist in the real world. And on the right, there is an electron microscope picture of what it looks like in real life. And you can really see that it has this angular head and stuff. So this is, by the way, one of the most advanced ones. This one is really big. It's really good at infecting certain bacteria. And there are hopes that maybe one day we can use these friends as antibiotics. Because these things are really good at killing bacteria. The problem we have with that so far is that each bacteriophage is only good for killing exactly one kind of bacteria. These are not generalists, these are specialists. So if we can find exactly which bacterium there is and find exactly the right bacteriophage, then we're good. But so far that's not happening. These guys, they do one thing, but they do it really well. On the right is also a thing called PhiX174, and that sounds lovely science fiction type. That was one of the first bacterial viruses that was ever discovered. The PhiX, as we call it, is really short. So in the computer antivirus world, there's a thing called the ICAR file. Who knows what an ICAR file is? Most of you do. So that's a file that if you see it, that every antivirus program is supposed to say, I have found a virus. It's like, you should see this. So this is one way of testing if your whole virus checking solution is actually working without sending people an actual virus, which would be dangerous. PhiX is a piece of DNA that encodes a bacterial virus. It does not make us ill. It's really one of the really nice things about PhiX. It's completely harmless to us. You could drink a whole bottle of it. What people do when they sequence DNA, they mix in a little bit of PhiX. So you can buy PhiX by the bottle. You get a whole bottle of PhiX DNA. And you drip a little bit of that into your DNA before you sequence it. And when you are done sequencing, you check if the PhiX actually came out, which is your signal that the whole machine is in fact working. If you run the whole thing and only PhiX comes out, that means that you put no other DNA in there, but you still have assurance that the machine works. The actual problem with our friend PhiX is that it is now in every DNA lab, in every pore, it's in everything. So even if you take a completely empty DNA sequencer and you turn it on, you will find a ton of PhiX. So no one in the world can do any PhiX research anymore. Which is a good thing because it has a very short genome and it was one of the first that has been fully read. So we already know all the dark secrets of the PhiX, but that's good because you would have to burn the DNA sequencer to the ground to do any research on it. So this is a very influential little animal, and it did nothing. I mean, it did nothing to do earn that except being a little bit small and harmless. That's also nice. So this is a slide that you also saw yesterday, that when the genes were discovered and we thought we were super superior and that people would surely have a million genes, and then it was 100,000 genes, and it was 60,000, 50,000, 40,000, and it's now 20,000. It's depressing if you think that the number of genes matters, because a potato has 40,000. But a potato is twice as genetic as we are. It's also a very impressive plant, by the way. Doesn't do these presentations though. Why is this so interesting? When we study bacteria, as I mentioned, bacteria are the original gangsters of DNA code. They write so tightly. The code they write is so clean. There's no wastage in there. There's a reason why that, for the way. When bacteria start to really be successful, they duplicate. And they do that every 20 minutes or so. And let's say you have two clients of bacteria. One takes 20 minutes to copy, and one takes 21 minutes to copy. You can see where this is going. After a few hours, the one that shaved 1 minute off it is now twice as big as the other one. So being 1 minute faster at copying means that you win as a bacteria. So that means that if you have any shitty code in there that does nothing, you lose. So everything, these guys have inverse bit rot. So we can learn from that. Now I'm going to truly blow your mind. Bacteria can double themselves in 20 minutes. Okay, that's rather nice. Copying the whole DNA of a bacterium takes 30 minutes. How does that work? Because you would want to make a whole copy of the DNA to get a new bacterium. Any ideas? Close. But how would the parallel processing work? It starts copying, it starts copying while it is copying. So the bacterium that is newly being formed says, well, hang on, I'm now completely formed enough that I will already start doubling. So they actually double while they double. Amazing. You should see what the human body does, by the way. Reading human DNA, it takes like 24 hours for a cell, which is longish. So the human DNA had like 1,000 or like or 50,000 even called copy forks. So it starts copying its DNA in 50,000 places at the same time. And then it all hooks that up together. Yeah. It's amazing we are here. I frequently get that feeling when I use a computer as well. So, but why this graph? So the back to bed and back. These bacteria, they are so clean and tight that every gene starts with "Hello, I'm a new gene," and then it ends with the gene ends here. And then there's even a little trailer that says, well, because the ribosome that reads the stuff has to actually fall off. So there's even a little bit of DNA that, when it forms this RNA, forms a loop. So it's a palindrome. And it forms a loop that loops back onto itself so that the ribosome falls off. It's like, nice. So these bacteria, they are super tight, and we know exactly where a gene begins and where a gene ends. It's very easy to analyze. If we look at the DNA of plants and us and other stuff, we have no clue. We cannot see where a gene begins or where it ends or what it does. There's no nice marker that says begin gene here. It's not there. We cannot find it. That is why originally we thought, oh, 100,000, because surely we are so important. But there was no basis on that. And to this day, when we try to figure out which parts of our genome are actually genes, it's a lot of guessing. Supercomputers are involved. There is like, yeah, we have seen one of these genes already, and that started like this, so it's probably that one as well. But we're not quite sure. And this number is probably going to go down a little bit further as we find that we have misclassified more junk DNA. And now, this is the one controversial slide of the whole presentation that I mentioned yesterday. So yesterday there were no controversial slides. This is the one original research part, so this is likely wrong. So we know that 97% of our DNA, which you could see here, the small red thing you see is the DNA that we know that actually turns into proteins. The other 98.5% sits there and does all kinds of things, but never turns into a protein. Let's say you are a virus, and you try to infect our DNA, because then you get turned into proteins and you can live forever. So for a virus, the holy grail is to really get into the DNA. We have a lot of defenses against that. So our DNA, for example, is in a nucleus, which is a real firewall. There's small gates in there. If you want to get there, you have to go through these gates. These gates check who you are. It's very complicated. You have to know the right codes, because otherwise it won't open up. But still, viruses, every once in a while, they get through there. And it is my theory. This is only my theory. The rest is solid science in these books. That one trick that our genome has been doing, it has been hiding where the real genes begin. Because we cannot find out with supercomputers. So apparently it's hard. Let's say you are a virus and you try to infect our DNA. You also don't know where to go. Because 98.5% of the DNA, you could infect it and nothing would happen. That means that you are not very successful in attacking DNA, because you're likely attacking stuff that will never lead to execution. So my personal theory is that the reason that we cannot find where the genes begin and where they end is that it's a form of steganography, where we have hidden the important genes among the noise. Now, real biologists by now go like, leave the room. But I'm putting this out there as a prediction. I would not be amazed if in the coming years we find that it's so hard to find out where a gene begins, because the gene does not want to be found. And there's apparently some secret way in which our bodies are able to find the beginning of the gene, which is a form of hiding your data in the noise. So that was all here. So this mercifully brings me to the end of the content we had going, but I would still like to wrap it up, because yesterday I made the rather bold claim that you can really understand DNA in terms that computer people understand, like it's a rate mirror, for example, or there are signals and slots that are being executed. There are Boolean operators that make sure that the bacteria only create glucose from lactose when there is lactose and no glucose. We have found that the bacteria can find the sugar cubes by modifying their swimming behavior based on simple genetic triggers. So my claim yesterday was, first, you can understand DNA better as a computer programmer, but two, you will find everything in DNA that you would recognize as a computer program, including malware, Boolean expressions, signals, copying, and all that stuff. And I hope that in the content that I have hopefully somewhat excited you with the last 1.5 hours, or I have sort of convinced you that this is true. Oh, and including, of course, the stupid things, like the stupid code reuse where we have the protein that runs the wrong way. And to compensate for that, we built this ridiculous machine that pulls in DNA backwards because we're too stubborn to make a second piece of DNA. These are things that you should maybe recognize from your interaction with software developers. I do at least. Oh, and of course, the ton of dead code lying around, because that was one item I did not quite cover. When we look at, for example, the human DNA, we find a ton of stuff in there that we don't know what it's for, but quite a lot of that is clearly leftover copies of old experiments.
Why is that clearly?
Because we can, that's a good. So let's now shift to where everyone can ask questions, if you have them, of course. I think you do. So why is that clearly? We see that we find one stretch of DNA that looks really like another stretch of DNA. But that other stretch of DNA, we see that end up as a protein. So we know that the other one is really being used. And then we have this copy that is slightly mutated from there, but is not being used. This is, so we call this some pseudogene. So it's, yeah, it looked like a gene, but we're not using it. Why is that cool for evolution? Let's say you evolve a protein, and you change the protein a bit, and now it doesn't work anymore, and you're dead.
Is it possible, I mean, just imagining this on the fly, but is that sort of backup material?
Yeah, that's exactly it. That's exactly it. So what the typical thing that happens with evolution is that it's not that there's just a lot of tinkering going on with the protein, because many proteins, they're not very tinker-friendly. So it means if you make one mistake, then you get a non-functioning thing. What you could do is make a copy of the protein and start tinkering with one copy of it. Maybe it's better, in that case we're all lucky. Maybe it's worse, in that case we at least had the old one still lying around. So that's one reason. And also I think it's a little bit like when you're a computer programmer and you have a file that you used to use in your project, but you don't use it anymore, but you feel like, well, I might be using that later on. You're not going to kick it out of the repository because it's good to have it around. So at least 1/4 of the DNA appears to be old crap. For which there maybe is no incentive to clean it up. And maybe that reason there is no incentive is that it serves as a nice, funny way for viruses to say, well, in fact, this old stuff, we're not using it.
Have there been attempts to just to take a piece of DNA, remove some of those things that are suspected to be used as copies, and see if it runs?
Yeah, that has been done. It works in some animals. So in some animals, they have worked really hard cutting out a lot of DNA that we don't know what it's for, and you end up with an actual living animal again. And in other animals, it really does not work. Yeah, so this is not a very helpful answer. To repeat the question was, have there been animals in which you have taken out pieces of DNA where you thought they didn't do anything, and did that deliver a working organism? And the answer is sometimes.
Wonderful.
Yeah, lovely stuff. Yeah.
I don't know if you tweeted this yesterday, so...
That's okay.
I read that there are large spaces between human DNA information, but you said that viruses are looking for the holy grail, so to say, but do they skip over that empty information? Can they just find the pieces they want to find, or does that empty information, because you have long stretches of anything, and then comes information.
It's a really good question, thank you, and this allows me to sort of expand a little bit on this particular mysterious bit. So the way DNA is laid out, there are whole areas of stuff that we don't quite know what they're for, and then there are active genes that we really know what they are for. So the insulin gene, for example. And the insulin gene starts out nicely. It says you need to take these amino acids and put them together and make the protein. And then in the middle of the gene, it says, okay, here comes a big comment block. And you should just cut that out. And the weird thing is, the really weird, strange, utterly weird thing, is this comment block is then fully transcribed from DNA to RNA. So the thing already knows that it will have to get rid of this. But first it turns it into RNA. And then it cuts it out, which is like compiling the comments and then not using them. Yeah. There are huge holy wars in the world of biology that say, what are these introns and extrons, as they are called, for? So So within all genes are the whole markers, sometimes 20, sometimes 100 of them, sometimes the comments are longer than the actual gene itself. And they are in there, they faithfully get copied. And if you ask people why they are there, then you're in for a long evening. Yeah, so maybe it is what you say, maybe it is because the viruses don't know where to begin and end, but it's actually not quite true because the beginning and the end of the comment block are very well marked. There's a really clear sign that says, okay, stop reading here, ignore all that stuff and cut it out. And then it says, okay, now you need to go on reading again.
So we don't know what those comment blocks are for. They are copied, but...
Well, actually, I think if you ask a real biologist, they say, I know exactly what it's for, and I will tell you no. And then you ask another biologist that this guy is full of shit. So we really don't know. I keep check of this subject every few years just to see that it's like going to a nice, horrible comment thread somewhere on /dot and going in, it's like, is VI still better than Emacs here? Are we done with that discussion? No! This is the same thing with these introns and extrons, so whatever biologist, so my official position, I'm an Emacs user, is that this is something that we'll have to wait it out. We'll have to wait out. But it's a real mystery, and you can investigate that mystery. So I will put in the presentation. I forgot to put it in. There's a link to my fun DNA software, which you can download it, and you can put DNA in there. And you can start hacking away at it. You can start figuring out. You can download the human genome, find some genes, see what they look like. See if you can find patterns, because some of you are among the best reverse engineers and forensic analysts in the world. This is a piece of code you've never seen, but you will be able to do stuff in there. This is why I've been up so late for the past few weeks, because I thought I've discovered something new. It looks like I didn't. And I did lose a lot of sleep. No. But you can too. Yeah.
Easily marked. They're yes. Easily marked if you can globally read the code. Do viruses globally read? Do they work
no.
along the code? Do they work like Turing heads on Turing machines?
No, that would be lovely. No, as far as I know, and you have to realize that, for example, let me get this book. You asked a very good question. Do viruses actually read the DNA? And you should realize that, and my answer is I don't think so. The reason my answer is I don't think so is that this book, and it's a huge book, I've been working on it for quite some while now, this book calls itself A Superficial Introduction. So now you know. It's a very impressive book, by the way. But my feeling is that it doesn't, because it's super slow to read DNA. And it's a lot of work. So what we actually see is that when a protein wants to do something with DNA, it makes sure that the protein has the right characteristics that it will be attracted to the right piece of DNA. But there's no scanning of the whole thing, it's attraction to the code, which in routers we call this content addressable memory. We say I want to go to the place in memory where I can find the following data, and then boom, goes there. So the introns and extrons are only clearly marked once you know where the gene begins. So maybe that's part of the secret.
Thank you again for your lovely two-second presentation. My question is about how you and how we look at DNA. You say DNA is like computer code. We should look at it like computer engineers. What is the possibility that you are wrong? Because of, I think you might have heard the theory about that we explain our human body with the ideas we have developed contemporary technology. So if we would have to explain the genome maybe 20 years ago, we would have used this digital metaphors.
I get it. So the question is, is the way we look at DNA shaped by especially our computing way of thinking? Are we getting it wrong? Are we anthropomorphizing nature, which it really hates? And it's a very real question. So in my presentation, I have tried to stick to the things that we absolutely know are true. So the Boolean expressions that are being used by the bacterium to activate the lactose operon, there is no there's no doubt about it at all that it works. And actually the biologists, when they try to explain that lack of room, they spend 2 pages explaining Boolean logic with whole tables in there. That's quite a curious thing for them. And so I think you're very right, because there is a danger that we, when you are a hammer, everything looks like a nail. That danger is real. But that's why in my presentation, because there are far funnier examples I could tell, where I don't know if they're true. These are the ones that you can look up in the big book and they will be there, and you'll read it and you'll go like, yep, that's how it happens. But there is a risk, it might be that everything is, I'm actually very sure that within the next 10 years, people will discover something about DNA that we go like, okay, we got half of it wrong. And then we will have a whole new interesting thing. Because it's still not clear, for example, how you can get a whole human being that can write horrible comments on VI and Emacs and Slashdot in 750 megabytes. I cannot download a Paint program in 750 megabytes. So yeah, the risk is real. So within 10 years, we will likely go like, oh, it's a bit different than we thought. Yeah.
You were talking before about this attraction of the different parts of DNA, and there is like this new Swiss Army knife in DNA hacking called CRISPR, and as far as I understood, it works a little bit like this, that it searches for patterns. Yeah. Maybe you can elaborate on this.
Well, actually, I cannot, and let me explain why. So look, first let me tell you the short story. Bacteria have also a very powerful immune system. So whenever a virus enters a bacterium, the DNA is just lying there. Our DNA is protected by the nucleus, this firewall, which is very powerful. In a bacterium, the DNA just lies there, which means that bacterial DNA gets infected with viruses all the time. And then the bacterium does something extremely clever. It goes to the DNA and cuts the virus out again. And it does that using templates, because it knows it has seen that virus before. Then it takes that template and removes that template from the DNA. And this is very powerful. We have now found out that this technique, which is called CRISPR-Cas9, which is a really nice name, especially when you learn that Cas again stands for CRISPR-associated protein. So it's like the GNU is not Unix. Let's go on. So the CRISPR-Cas9, and eventually we'll learn that 9 also stands for CRISPR. I don't know. We have found out that this CRISPR mechanism also works on human beings and on everything else. And it seems to be super duper powerful. If you search right now on Google for CRISPR, you will find a CRISPR at home kit. And I shiver at the thought. But it appears that this is a very powerful cut and paste tool for DNA, which we will hear a lot more about. One thing I do caution you, if you read about CRISPR, any article that goes like, oh, the miracles are arriving, tone it down a little bit. It is a very serious breakthrough. But what it exactly means, we don't know yet. For example, we already know that it will not just remove the DNA that you want it removed, it will also remove the DNA that looks a little bit like it, which is called off-target effects. So these off-target effects have a way of killing you. If I had to make a prediction, I think that CRISPR will become so big that in the hacker community, maybe 8 years from now, people here will walk around and say, well, I fixed my own night blindness. I'm sure if we have to believe them at the time, but it will be that easy to manipulate DNA. If it will be effective or wise, I don't know. So be careful. Yeah, that's a scary bit. That's a super duper scary bit about CRISPR. CRISPR can work on living, and it's not that easy. You still need a virus, and the virus needs to go to the right place. And there have been some very interesting recent developments, which is sort of unfair, where they take a virus to deliver the CRISPR thing, but it only works if you have never been exposed to that virus. If you had that virus as a childhood, the therapy no longer works. So it's rather, but it's very strange. It will allow runtime patching. By the way, I deliberately did not include this in my presentation because so much is unsure about it, and I wanted to stick to the things that we actually really know. And CRISPR is probably 90% reality and 10% super duper hype. But the problem is no one knows which 10%. So.
First use an Eats virus.
Yeah, people have done the weirdest things. Don't go there.
Oh, and I also read that finding start codons, there was a theory that it could be done finding the way DNA is folded. Have you heard about that?
That is true. So let's step into the VI Emacs holy war a little bit. Why do we have these introns and exons? So I mentioned this yesterday a little bit. Let's say you make a string of DNA and it's all A, and on the other hand it's all CC, like T. And these two bind really tightly. They really love each other. That means that I can get a piece of DNA that is almost impossible to copy, because it binds so tightly. But let's say I really had a need to encode all those letter A's. One thing I could do, I could put a whole bunch of T's, like 12 of them, and put a little comment there. Some random other DNA in there, and then I go on with all my T's, and some other comments. So one theory is that the comments are a way of expressing the DNA that you want without making the DNA super clingy. And this is the same thing that happens in ATM, networks or in hard disks, where you say we cannot encode 20 North Poles in a row because then we created a giant North Pole. So we have decided that we all have these transitions, because otherwise we would make code that is impossible to read. So one theory is that if you would take out all the comments out of the DNA, then it would actually fold incorrectly and you would never get it open again. But that doesn't quite explain why there's so much of it. See if there's anyone that has not asked a question yet. We go to you.
Yeah, you said the human DNA was 700 megabytes or something?
750 may end up being 770, but I don't think the 20 megabytes are going to make the difference.
Then why did it take so long for the human genome project to unravel it?
Well, that's a good question. So we've long been able to read DNA, far longer than you would think. There was a guy called Fred Sanger, I think he was called Fred. He's one of the rare people that won two Nobel Prizes in the same field also. And he invented the technique to read DNA, which is, he invented it, he didn't give it a good name. So you know what happened, the technique is now called Sangering, because he didn't give it a good name. And you can read DNA really letter by letter that way. It appears visibly as dots. It takes ages to do that. But people have been able to do this for like 40 years or something like that. But they knew that if we want to read the whole genome of a human being that way, it would like take a billion years. But it didn't work, or like 100 million years, whatever, but unfeasibly long. And then they found a technique where they could quite quickly read like 50 letters of DNA at a time.
Was that the random?
Yeah, the shotgun sequencing. Yeah. Okay. So what you do, you take the 3.5 billion letters of human DNA, you cut it up. There are nice proteins that already do this. So it's nice. We could use nature to cut up DNA. You cut it up in billions of pieces. And then you read those pieces of 50 letters of DNA. And then you get the world's largest jigsaw puzzle. Because you read them in random order. It's not like the DNA lines up there and says, well, please read me. No, it's just these things fly all over the place. So you get billions and billions of pieces of 50 letters of DNA, which, of course, then they all overlap a little bit. Because you have many copies of the DNA, so you can find how they line up. So it's a little bit like a paper shredder, in which you put 100 copies of the same page. And you shred it in all kinds of different ways. And that allows you to really reconstruct the original page. But at 50 letters, it's not that much. It's not too unique. So it took ages of time to get the 50 letters, because those machines were not fast. But there were whole rooms full of them. There were literally like these sort of factory floors full of reading machines that spent reading a DNA 50 letters at a time. And then they still had to figure out, are we actually making sense? Is it actually correct what we're seeing? Because let's say you have a very long string of very repetitive DNA. And you find a piece of DNA that would fit here, but would also fit here, would also fit here. How long is that piece of DNA? We don't know. So this was a huge challenge. Actually, when President Clinton back at the time Remember how we thought he was bad, by the way. He came on TV and he announced, "Yeah, we finished the human genome project." And in the background, all kinds of biologists, they were dying when he said that. Well, they were not, because they got all the kinds of money to do this. But when they were ready, they were like 95% ready, they thought. And it's now 20 years later. And at first they said, well, we're 95% ready. The current estimate, 20 years later, is that we're 93% ready. So we're actually going backwards. So it is a huge challenge to do it. And one of the horrible things, like I said, DNA, the human genome is like 3 meters long, something like that. Which is rather powerful for a cell that is a few micrometers on the side. You can stick 3 meters in there. So it's curled and curled, and within the curls there are curls. And there are parts that are so curled that we are not able to get them out of there. So there are like 7% of the DNA that we think that we've never seen. So it's an ongoing project. DNA was not meant for us to be easy to read. We're working on it.
Just a very silly question, but when you sequence the DNA, let's say with the genome project,
yeah.
Whose DNA is that?
Okay, this is a very nice question. Thank you for this question, because it has a so fun answer. So when we sequence the DNA, when we say this is the human genome project, who is this genome? Who is this person? Who is this human that we took? So they had held meetings over it because they said, eventually said, we need to sequence something, some sort of consensus sequence. So they said, we're going to pick 5 anonymous people and we're going to mix their DNA and sequence that so we don't get too much bias in one direction. And this was already a sort of weak proposal. And it's not what they did. There was a guy called Craig Venter. And Craig Venter is like the sort of Linus Torvalds of DNA. So while he's somewhat of a dick at times, he has achieved some big things. And but Craig Venter is out there. And Craig Venter thought, hey, this is my project. So he substituted his own DNA. And but he got punished because he found out he has a gene for early onset dementia. But he does know what to do against that, he says. So that's who they picked. Right now we can sequence DNA so quickly that we are doing whole 1,000 genome projects. We're taking 1,000 people, all sequencing all their 1,000 DNA and seeing how they compare. Daphne.
That's the answer of my question, because we have now more.
They did include female DNA. I don't actually know what Craig Venter did to fake the female DNA in there. His wife, I think, I don't know. That's a good question. But we're now sequencing people by the thousands, which again teaches us, by the way, that we are far different than we thought. There was this old saying that people barely differ from each other, but it's not true. We differ in rather big ways from each other.
I have one question.
Yes, please.
When they say they can identify us not by fingerprints, but by DNA, what does this mean?
So let me tell you, so the question is, when you can identify people by DNA and not by fingerprints, how does that work? It's a stupendously good question. I keep trying to understand it. So I try to read it, I try to figure out, and there are pieces of DNA that get copied very inefficiently and incorrectly, and it gets copied incorrectly, differently in every person. But I'm really not an expert in it, because I honestly don't understand it. And I don't think actually that it's my problem. I think it's being explained really badly.
What can be about the sequencing of the DNA of groups of persons? Is that being done in order to find the genetic factors that can actually cause the kind of sequences?
Yeah, we want to try to figure out, and here's another dark secret of DNA. So we're trying to sequence many people and then learn what changes in DNA cause what behavior. So maybe there's... And the original thought that we looked at would be a gene for being friendly, and it would be a gene for being smart. And because we got tricked, because it turns out there is a gene for blue eyes, for example. We can very clearly say that you will have blue eyes based on this DNA. It turns out that almost every aspect that we have, if we are tall, if we are dark, if we have a lot of hair, if we have no hair, is not determined by one part of the DNA, but by tens of thousands of parts of the DNA all working together. And I found this out when I entered the DNA field. I want to find out what is the genetic difference between a pony and a horse. Because surely someone has figured this out. No. There are thousands of places that determine if you are a pony or a horse. I have none of those 1,000 places. So we are trying to learn, but it turns out that new statistics are now being used. This is something from the last 3 years, I think, where we have given up finding for the one switch that says pony, horse, and then we have learned statistical measures to indicate for all the positions in DNA how much they influence the poniness of a horse. And these are, by the way, very impressive statistical calculations because they have to happen over 3 billion digits of places of DNA.
So you said that about 98% of the genome does not go through proteins.
Yes. This is a very, you have to be very, very precise in these questions.
Yes. So how come these things, these pieces of DNA never get transcribed into proteins? Does that mean those parts never attract any systems that transcribe them somehow? So they never become RNA? Or?
Yeah. That's what it starts with, but. Like I said, you have the bacteria. The bacteria are rather simple. We really get how they work, and we can kill them by the billions, and no one asks a question. This is more difficult with horses and stuff. Also expensive. So the question is, why are some parts of the proteins transcribed and some of them not? And what we have learned is that the human genome is like 5 times more difficult to understand than the bacterial one. So let me give you a very concrete example. Before a piece of DNA is turned on in a bacteria, we saw in the Lac operon for the conversion from lactose to glucose that there were 2 things that had to happen, and then it would start creating the genes that convert lactose into glucose. For human beings, the best I could find in this subject is that it requires at least 17 systems to cooperate. So we really don't know, to be honest.
So that means that those non-coding parts require a combination of situations to happen at the same time, but in practice never happened, which means those genes or those pieces of DNA never actually do anything on them.
Yeah, that's it. But it's very tricky for us to figure out which 17 factors these are.
Of course.
But yeah, and the DNA, but it's still says.
Is it true that some parts of DNA get activated or not activated also based on external factors which are not only visible?
So there's a very interesting process called imprinting. Thank you. The question was, are there pieces of DNA that are turned on or off based on external factors? The simplest answer for that is, of course, yes, as we saw in the bacteria with the Lac operon, which only works if the bacterium is swimming in an environment with lactose. Otherwise, the DNA never becomes active. But the more broader question, what we now know is that when organisms are born, their DNA is sort of boot time edited, boot time optimized. It's a process called methylation, and methylation goes with a sort of brush of the DNA and says, well, don't do this one, and do less of this one. And this depends on the characteristics of your, we think, your mother while you were pregnant. Or while she was pregnant. Only bacteria are pregnant while they're pregnant. People cannot do that. And so yeah, there's runtime editing, and we don't really understand any of that. But yeah, it happens. And we know that this tuning is necessary. Because sometimes the tuning will mean eat a lot in winter and not in summer. Because that works where you are born. I had already promised him. So you're next. You're next. Please wait.
Now, how does sheep dummy fit into all this?
Sheep Dolly was cloned, and that was a very big success. The one thing I can say about Sheep Dolly is that the institute that cloned the Sheep Dolly actually reviewed my DNA page and said, yeah, there are 5 mistakes in there. Oh, that's bad, and they're all typos. So that's the relation I have with the Sheep Dolly. By now it's very routine to clone animals, but we also see that it causes problems, which probably has to do with this imprinting process, which does not happen the same way when you clone an animal.
My son DNA affected all of the genes.
Yeah, he told yesterday.
Which causes magnetic effects and all kinds of things.
Yeah, no, it's a very important process, otherwise you end up with Dolly the sheep, who was also not optimal, put it that way. We're nearing sort of the end of our time. I'm not sure if anyone's, because there will be a different speaker. 7th, okay. A few more questions. Yeah?
I just wonder, you told us that you do private research on DNA structures.
Yeah, and you can do that as well. Because it's you can download, in the presentation from yesterday, you saw the URL where you can download the human genome. It's a 3.5 gigabyte file.
Okay.
Which is strange, because there's only 750 megabytes in DNA. So why is it 3.5 megabytes? Because these people encode DNA as ASCII. But it's worse encoding it in XML. So you can download that thing, and if you understand the structure, the annotations as they call it, you can start looking for similarities. You can see, can I find this pattern somewhere else? Can I find the difference between where a gene is, where it not is? Can you do statistical things in that? And one of the things I ran into, and it did not quite pan out, is there's a problem called the DNA compressibility problem, which means if you run GZIP or 7-zip or whatever DNA, it does not get smaller. Even though we know that there's a ton of repeats and stuff in there. So I thought I had found a way to compress DNA into half its size, and then it turns out I was fooling myself. So then I stopped doing that, but I'm still hopeful that we can do something in that direction. But you can actually, the DNA is studied so little by computer people, by cryptologists, by forensics, by reverse engineer people. It is entirely possible that one of you will download the DNA and start hacking away at it and discover something new. You can't do that, because the field is ready for us to look into. We have skills that are relevant, we have skills that the biologists do not bring, and we can actually make, and this actually happens also. There are relative outsiders that come in and say, hey, this is weird, I found something, and then they discover that no one else had found that out. So you can actually do it, and it's a ton of fun. There's no easier way, I know, of getting into science and having the hope of actually discovering something. And also, you can just download it. So I think we have one final question, and then we really have to wrap it up. After the presentation, I will go outside and stand with you so we can just talk on. It's a fun person, I think, the guy with the beard.
So they know for certain things what they are for, how they work, like the lactose thing. Did they find concurrent solutions for the same problem already? So concurrent libraries, so to say.
I'm not sure if they've... I can guarantee you that they have. I can give you one example that I really like, which is the eyes. So we know that eyes have evolved around 7 times independently. How do we know that they evolved independently? Because their DNA looks nothing alike. And 7 of these, so there are 7 attempts, 5 of these are like our eyes, so they're somewhat different, but the octopus, for example, has eyes that work like a camera. So we focus by bending the lens, and an octopus focuses by moving the lens. And we see that it is true parallel evolution, because the DNA is completely different. But I'm pretty sure that the DNA internally does many things inefficiently, or twice. Okay. With that, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.